Hello, everybody. Good afternoon. It's good to see so many friends and family, friendly faces that are to honor my father today. My dad's love and pride in the St. Joseph High School band program, you know how strong that was, but that was only second to his love, pride, and commitment to his family, which I'd like to introduce right now. My mother. Please stand, Mom. Liza and Harper. My husband, Robert Fry, wasn't able to be here today. He got called on an emergency work trip. But my daughter, Gabrielle, is here. She's 17. And my daughter, Samantha, is here. And then my mom's brother, Jerry, and his wife, Mary, and their daughter, Sarah. And my mom's other brother, Don and Carol. Their son, Michael, and daughter, Bessie, and other son, John. And all through here are all the other cousins, grandkids, the larger family. I have many memories of this day. I was asked to speak at this memorial, obviously, and I thought about what I would say. And I thought about being on a stage up here before performances, and if there's students in the audience, they'll probably relate to this very well. I closed my eyes and I thought about what it was like to be lining up behind these curtains before a performance, and well, I was going to talk about the red velvet curtains, but they're gone. Darn. And we would line up and take our orderly places on the stage, sit in our chairs, scoot them back and forth on the wooden floor and get our music all situated, and you know, nobody knew better than to be louder than a hush, hush, hush. And then when the auditorium was quiet, my dad would come out on the front of the auditorium and make a big thud as he took the podium, right? Raise his arms and look over each of those glasses, make some kind of funny face, and the arms would go and the room would just fill with music. And that's the memory that I hold up here. I'm so honored to be up here one last time with my father, I'm sure, to honor his memory. My dad was born on December 28, 1933. He grew up in Trenton, Michigan. He attended the University of Michigan, where he earned his first bachelor's in 1955 in music. That was his first. He then served in the Army for 2 years, and after serving, he returned to the University of Michigan, received another bachelor's and a master's in music education. He then married my mother in 1962. Kim and I came next. He was a conductor of bands here from 1963 to 1993, so he was here 30 years. For most of his career, he had a brief stint in another school system. During his education and his career, he developed close friendships with his roommates at college, students in the band, and colleagues. And you're going to be hearing both musically and verbally from a variety of those people that he knew over those periods of time in his life. Since retirement, he spent time in Michigan and Florida. My sister lives in Florida. So they would go between the two states, trying to spend as much time with each of us as they possibly could with the 5 grandchildren. In his retirement, he absolutely loved to cook. It would be a very long project of his to make a wonderful meal. He loved to fish as much as he possibly could. And I guess probably the top thing would be watching football. And the later on in his life, the more football there was. I think he watched Big Ten Network about 24/7. So my mother always found something else to do, and my dad watched I don't know how many of the college football games over and over and over. Most of you know him as a band conductor, which was strict, structured, with high expectations. Those attributes resulted in an accomplished career for both him and his students. I knew him both as a student and as my dad. When I think of him as a student and what it meant to be part of his band, the memories that are the strongest is the pride pride that we had in the band program. And we all know that that starts from the top and trickles down. And my dad was so proud of his band program and the students in it. And the way that they were able to rise to the occasion and beyond his expectations, because we know his expectations were very, very high. I remember being in the band program with our challenging performances. We were not going to take the easy way out. And I think back on that, and I am so proud of that. I'm proud of creating the stadium. I don't think there's anything like that jamming with the drum cadence and all of us as a unit and as a community that we built. I'm proud of the outstanding halftime performances that we were able to deliver. And I want to thank Bucky, Warren Buckleitner. For those of you that are Facebook users or are not aware yet, but there's a tribute page on Facebook for my father that was set up a few days after he died. There's over 400 members right now, but the very coolest thing is there's a lot of written memories, comments, there's videos, there's photos of old programs. It's just a plethora of information about the band program and my dad and people's specific experiences. My dad always had very high standards, like we all know what I was talking about. He was always on band members who were dogging it, which if you weren't in the band, that meant you weren't working as hard as he thought you should be working. And he'd say, don't dog it. Well, he'd always threaten to kick somebody out of the practice for dogging it. And he never really did until he did it to me. I was literally the only person that I know of, and you guys know something different, in 30 years that was asked to sit on the sidelines for dogging it. Which I really don't think I was, but he said I was. He's always teasing me. As a father, I knew him as a prankster who had an amazing sense of humor throughout his whole life. And I can't underscore that enough. Sometimes it was very subtle. Sometimes it was very clear that he meant to be humorous. He loved to tease people. He was always trying to make people laugh, even through the end to his illness, including the nurses and the doctors and the family. And, a very easy patient. We all, I know, have had experiences in the hospital and we've got the patients that nobody wants to care for. And, you know, my dad was just a wonderful patient and the nurses loved him and the doctors loved him. He got me really good the week before he died with his sense of humor. I had arrived not really knowing exactly what to find. He was in the hospice program. And he was in a hospital bed and I didn't really know what to do. He was laying there kind of pretending to be asleep and I hear this. And I went running over there and I put my cheek on his head. Dad, it's okay. It's okay. Dad, it's fine. We're here. He's going, He just kept on getting louder and louder. I didn't know what to do. And I'm like, Dad, you're going to be fine. And all of a sudden, his eyes flew open and he smiled at me and he goes, I gotcha. That's my dad. You know, there's never an opportunity where things were serious. He was going to turn it around, and he was going to make the best of it with his wonderful sense of humor. One of the favorite memories that I just want to share, because it's one of my favorite memories, and I wrote about it on Facebook, is in the year 2010. Our family, Kim, myself, Mom, and Dad, were able to spend two fantastic vacations together, which was very unusual. We spent the summer at Harold's Resort, a week in the summer at Harold's Resort, which was a place that our family vacationed very frequently with family or by ourselves. I've taken my daughters there now as a second generation. And that's a really laid back, small inland lake that my dad absolutely loved to go fishing on and catch bass and perch and bluegill, roast marshmallows, just take it really easy. And we were so pleased that we were able to go there one more time as a family, and he was out on the water and driving the pontoon boat. And a lot of the stuff is posted on Facebook, which I think you'll really enjoy. Then the second vacation, we were all able to get together as a family again in Disney World in December, which is, again, very unusual, but that had significant significance to us because we were able to ride the rides together because Disney World is such a friendly family place. Nobody had kind of left behind, but that was most importantly the time that my sister's announced that she was expecting twins. So it was really a special family moment. The other thing that I mentioned that I will probably miss, one of the things about my dad the very most is his unconditional love. He took pride in his family and all of our accomplishments. And as he got further away from his career in the band program, it was an important period of his life. But whenever he discussed or a stranger would discuss things with him, it was always family, family, family. My daughters, these are my grandkids, this is my wife, all the things that we're up to, everything that we've accomplished. I went down this summer, I spent a lot of time in Florida this year, but I went down the summer before he had a pacemaker put in June, and I thought this would be a surprise visit because I'm, like him, a prankster. And Kim picks me up from the airport, and she goes into the house, and I kind of go between the bushes, and I get in the house, and I walk into my dad's room, and his face just lights up when he sees me. And that is what I'm going to miss the most, is not having that feedback from a person with his unconditional love. So with that, I thank him for the gift of his humor and his patience, his unconditional love, and the ability to really hear the music in a song. A lot of people that I know that maybe had the opportunity to be in a music program will hear the lyrics, or they might hear, you know, the top music, whatever the technical terminology is. But being in the music program, I can hear the drums, and I can hear the bass, and I can hear the flutes and clarinets, and I can hear the timpani. And I am so grateful that I have that ear when I listen to whatever kind of music it might be, to actually really hear the notes and the music. My dad said to me, again, in the week before he died, that the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. He was referring to me. I know that. But as I look out in the audience, I look at all of these people here who were affected by him, who loved him, who were inspired by him, and inspired him, and I know that you are also apples that did not fall far from his tree. Thank you.
Thank you. friend of Bob's from college days, right down through the present. I have never had a friend who was more sincere than Bob. We grew up from basically small towns. Our families had raised us with the same both in morals and ethics, and we had so much in common. Now, the one thing that probably wasn't in common was I grew up in Blissfield, which is called the town, and he grew up in Trenton, which they called at that time a city. The difference being whether you had one gas station or two. We were in school together, we taught together, we roomed together, and at that time, we were both single, of course, and both kind of wondering where we were headed from there, because the other college friends and their wives and husbands had moved on. And we discussed life and things related to this and other things. And I said a few minutes ago, none of which I would be ashamed to tell you about for one second. And as we discussed these things, we put together where we were headed in life. The one thing I remember best about Bob, we were rooming together, we had bunk beds. I was on the bottom, he was on the top. And when the alarm would go off, I never saw anyone bounce out of bed and be running on step one as he was. I've thought about that so much. I tried it a time or two myself, and I wound up running into the door, so that was for me. And it was not for me. But as we lived there, one day, he said, I'd have you meet someone. As far as I was thinking, that. She came in with her nursing school dress on, remember? And so there were three in the group. And not too long after that, Lois and I came together. And then there were four in the group. And we were married a week apart, us on June 15th and him on June 27th. And we're at each other's weddings, and have remained close, of course, ever since. The few times we got together, it was to tell war stories, as we say, and it seemed like we never got to the end of the war stories. But those are things that were really funny if you were there to see them. We had a lot of fun. So today, I guess I can only say goodbye, my friend. I miss you. I always will.
Years passed, I moved away before I went to the high school, and upon graduation from the University of Michigan, I got a phone call from someone who said they were looking for an orchestra teacher at St. Joe High School. I thought, gosh, it's been a long time since I've been there. I better make a phone call. So I called, and they invited me over, and there was my old teacher, Bob Brown. And we spoke with Bert Aldridge and Bob Brown, and director, I'm sure I met Vito, Tenorelli, and Dennis Bowen. They asked me to come back the very next day to go around to schools, and they said, we want you to show up to work on Monday. So I was very privileged to work with Bob for 4 years of my brief public school teaching career, and learned a lot from him, not only as a colleague and a mentor, but we became friends, and over the years we've stayed in touch. I've moved on. I'm a professional string bass player now in Omaha, Nebraska, and we've gotten a chance to visit with each other. One of my fondest memories is when I was fortunate enough to be a sub in the Detroit Symphony. Dad and Bob came over, and I invited them to join me for dinner and come to a concert where I was playing. And that really meant a lot to me that you were both able to come over. So I just wanted to share that little side of Bob, about his string teaching ability. He was the orchestra director here briefly. And I'm very privileged to have known Bob as a teacher and as a mentor and a colleague, but also as a friend.
My name is Steve Reed, assistant band director here at St. Joseph High School under Bob Brown from 1977 and until I just retired in 2010. So worked side by side Bob Brown from 77 when he hired me right through his retirement in 1993, so 16 years. A lot of memories about Brown. And reading all the Facebook tributes that have been put up, and there's 400 members on that now, looking at all the photos many of you and others have posted, listening to the tributes tonight, this afternoon, remind us all what a great man RWB was. How much he meant to all of us, whether he knew it at the time or not. I think most students, and certainly St. Joe band grads, fall into this, didn't realize at the moment what a great experience participating in one of Bob Brown's bands really was. Until after graduation, they have a chance to look back and remember, as Angie so graciously started out this afternoon, things you remember back in the day and how important they were. When you're marching in the mud, getting yelled at, or getting stung by bees at band camp, it's not that much fun until you look back on it. And you can laugh at the experience and brag about having survived it. And not only survived it, but excelled. I came to know Bob Brown in 1977 while interviewing for the job here for assistant band director position. The band program had grown so much that he needed help. I remember Bob having over 100 kids in the ninth grade band in New York. He called it the varsity band. My assignment was going to be teaching the beginning brass and percussion at the elementary schools and concert band and jazz ensemble. School level. Back then he called it the stage band. Remember those years. I'd been only out of college for 2 years and I'd been teaching at a small Class D school system in South Kalamazoo, Marcellus. Coming to St. Joseph was like a dream job with a truly comprehensive music department with great choirs led by Dennis Bowen and Ren Baldwin, an orchestra program, theater productions, including Showtime and Broadway show every spring, even music theory in the curriculum. From where I was coming from, that was going to be Bob and Dennis were in charge of everything in this school system. It sure seemed like it to me. And fine arts ruled at St. Joseph High School. This was where you wanted to be, in the fine arts department. I was really only a few years older than the students here, a couple of years out of college. So I had a lot to learn. Of course, I thought I knew everything. I thought I knew a few things about teaching. After all, I had a college degree, and I'd already been teaching 2 years. I knew what I was doing. But when I got here, and I watched Bob run on the marching field and in class, I realized I knew absolutely nothing about how to teach and how to motivate kids to do what you want them to do. Not at his level, anyway. I certainly didn't know anything that I was, what I was up for. That first interview, he had me come out to the 6-hour marching band rehearsal to observe the marching band. I was looking at the job. They were looking at me, I guess. I couldn't get there from my job in Marcellus until after school. So I showed up, and here was the entire marching band rehearsing. Practice field, which was out here on the field. You guys will all remember that. Working hard the afternoon heat after school. It's probably an hour after school. The St. Joe marching band rehearsed every day, 6th hour, for an hour, and an hour after school. They don't do that anymore. Well, we used to back then. The discipline and the energy of that band rehearsal was amazing to me. I'd never seen anything like it. I thought for sure that he had put the band up to this, and that they were prepping, and they were performing for me, because I was the new guy and wanted to show up to the new guy. I thought, they couldn't possibly do this every single day. I was completely wrong. It was just a normal rehearsal. That band worked hard every single day, and for really only one reason. Because Bob Brown demanded it. Why did they do this? Were his students scared of him? Maybe. But they wanted to do it for him. They wanted to give their all for Bob Brown. They also knew that if they didn't give their all, if they were slapping him a little bit, they'd be running it back. Right? Run it back, time and time again, until it was right. Bob's teaching philosophy of hard work pays off. The group is more important than the individual. Striving for excellence, and teamwork and pride are the two most important things to strive for. Stayed with me all 35 years of my teaching career. Everything that I ever did right in music education, I learned from Bob Brown and Dennis Ball. Of course, there were some other master teachers here too at St. Joseph High School. Joe Collins, Ron Bogan, Don Fredrickson, Benny Tyson. But I couldn't have had a better mentor teacher to follow and try to emulate than Bob Brown. The music that was playing today as you came into the auditorium meant something important to Bob. We heard a little bit of the Chopin Sonata No. 2 that he played on piano as a college student and beyond. The Sansons Organ Symphony that you heard as you came in, if you happen to be listening to that, was one of his favorite pieces. Annette told me the story that when they were younger at the University of Michigan, they went to Ann Arbor Hill Auditorium and heard the University of Michigan Orchestra do that with E. Power Biggs playing the organ part. Motivated by Brown. So we played that for you today. And the jazz group that we put together here just a few minutes ago, I think Bob would have enjoyed that. Some of his colleagues and his former students were on the stage just then. And it's a reminder that Bob was also a great jazz musician and loved to improvise on piano, saxophone, and clarinet, and loved to put together jazz ensembles for his schools. Bob was intense. If you were one of his former students, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Bob was intense, especially if things weren't good or if things weren't sounding the way he wanted them to sound, or the band wasn't working as hard as he wanted you to work. I remember one Wednesday night rehearsal in the stadium. Game show coming up in 2 days. The band wasn't performing up to standards, again. He used to come out to the rehearsal with just a megaphone, you know, battery-operated megaphone, which was bad enough, you know, when he would yell into it. He would get that angry thing going. But this particular year, he figured out how to get hooked up into the PA system in the stadium. You know, it was always his wish that he could do that. And so he figured out how to do that. And he was hooked up into that PA system, and we had it cranked up pretty good. So, he was also in rare form that night. Shall we say, instructing the band on everything they were doing wrong, the alignment, the lack of energy, musical prowess wasn't what he wanted it to be. So he got pretty heated up, and of course, when his energy level was heated up, you know, the intensity got really scary. Well, the next day, he got called into the principal's office at the high school. The school had been called by the hospital. It's like a mile or two away. It seems that some of the patients were actually getting scared from what they were hearing. From that marching band, they couldn't make out what was going on, but they could hear the yelling. And they couldn't sleep. You know, it was 9 o'clock at night, and it was dark, and you know, there was somebody really angry. So, principal, I think it was Rod Place, I'm not sure who it was, but warned him to tone it down on Wednesday nights. And you know, if you know Bob, he said, okay. He didn't change a thing. You know, and he smiled at me and he said, I'm not doing anything different next Wednesday night, not a thing. Of course, every household between here and there also heard everything that was going on. They were locking their doors and windows, I'm sure. Now, we laughed about that quite a bit. Bob's legacy is one of excellence and pride. He taught his students, and I count myself as one of them, way more than music. He taught those kids how to live their lives, how to strive for excellence in everything they do, never settle for mediocre results. Hard work will result in success. He certainly taught everyone to love music, but he taught all of those life lessons through the music. He was really teaching every one of his students life skills. Kim and Angie, you had a great dad. He taught you all those things firsthand, and you can be really proud of that. But you can also be very proud that he also touched so many other lives as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve, for that great tribute to Bob. My name is Vito Tenorelli, and before I give much thought to exactly what all the things that Steve talked about and all the things that mean so much to so many people, I'd like to see all of the students of Bob's who are in this room today, all the kids that were kids back in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s, all of those people, stand up and let's give all those people a big round of applause. Wow, what a thrill, what a thrill. My wife, Ann, and Walsh Generelli, and I were in Bob's bands when he first came to St. Joe back in the 60s. And that was quite a while ago. I was a trumpet player and Ann was a flute player. And we, of course, in those days, immediately realized the significance that Bob meant to all the students. We weren't quite as large a band then. We were like 60 kids in the band compared to what it came to. But it was a very, very close group of kids, just like all of you people that were in the band in your classes were very, very close. And we recognized and were inspired by Bob. And personally, because Ann and I were both in the band, we worked closely together, we were inspired, we both became teachers. And Bob really encouraged students to become teachers. And he encouraged me greatly to develop my musical talent, and I became a band director as well, and came back to St. Joe and taught. And so I taught, not only I knew Bob as a student in high school, but then as a colleague as well. Annette Brown and her family graced our house this Thanksgiving with their families for Thanksgiving dinner. And we all sat around the dinner table, and while we were eating the turkey and all the dressing and things that went along with it, the stories flew. And if you think that the stories that Steve Reed just mentioned, if you thought those were good, you should have heard the ones that we talked about yesterday. it was a lot of fun. But anyway, Annette asked me if I could mention a few things on behalf of the family. One of those is that a scholarship fund has been established for St. Joe High School band students at Blue Lake Fine Arts Camp. I know many of you know about that, but if you haven't had an opportunity to contribute to that fund and you would like to do something for the family and in memory of Bob, please contact Blue Lake Fine Arts Camp, or I think you can get that information from the website that's been set up, or you can contact Annette or me, and we'll get that information to you. But a wonderful, wonderful tribute to Bob would be for you to be part of that scholarship fund for St. Joe band students for summer music. And I know that Bob would be just absolutely thrilled to know that people on his behalf are still helping kids develop their musical talent and contribute to St. Joe. Those kids would be from the St. Joe band, would be administered through the Blue Lake Fine Arts Camp, but would be St. Joe High School band students. So please, if you can, if you haven't done so yet, please consider that as a tribute to Bob. Also, the next thing that we have on the program is something I think you'll enjoy, and that is a director's video. This video was done at Band Festival at LMC. In those days, when we would take a band to festival, we would be judged by three judges and then go and do sight reading. And for a while, we were also, to try and help our directors, we also hired a judge to actually judge the director on his conducting ability. And he would stand behind the stage with a microphone, and then they would videotape the director coming this way. So the director was here facing the band, conducting the band, then the videotape was actually facing the director. And then a college director would actually critique the band director. And so we have a videotape. It's actually something that the family had found with Bob's things. And it showed the genius of Bob Bremer. And the family thought it would be excellent to share that with everyone in the audience. So it's the symphony band at festival, but the focus is on the wonderful work that Bob does. So we're going to show that now. Thank you.
Nice. That's beginning. Good. Good. I like it. developer contracts, yeah, like that, yeah. Nice, I like that. Good, like that. Nice, like that. Side to side thing you do. I think it fits the music nicely, and it obviously serves a purpose for you. Boy, they wouldn't let me do that in Illinois.
Bob designed a show around that. And so there are other stories that came out of how he built his show around students. He also had laser eyes. Do you remember experiencing the gaze? Bruce Bartz is here. I don't know why they give the trombone players water bottles. It's a bad idea. And they set them behind the trumpets. That's bad too, because the slides keep hitting me on the head. But I was when I was a sophomore, I got a chance to play a very short little solo, I think in the Civil War suite. It was in the second section. And I was really excited about it, very, very, extremely nervous. And the trombones had filled up my mouth with water. And so I was ready, you know, and I got that cue. You saw it. And I blew, and water shot out. And I got a look. He would stand there, and he would fry you with his eyes. That was what a master teacher could do. And I think in that moment, he was able to assess that the trombone players were really the culprits, and he knew he was smart enough to move on. Other fish to fry, you got to keep the rivers going. But he was able to control the room. When he walked into the room, he just commanded your attention. He was one of those very rare people. And again, this was not common. We were really lucky to have that, as Steve was saying. We were so fortunate. And I like that this is Thanksgiving, because we can all be grateful for that. Steve mentioned the voice of God on Wednesday nights, and then I just saw Tom Crowder over there. I'll never forget, we couldn't see him. And we go out there, we march, we do what we have to do, and then we kind of wait, and then the voice of God.
Mr. Crowder. As you were, Mr. Crowder.
And then Tom would look up and say, how do I work? So that's why the hospital got the call. When I was in high school, the drinking age changed from 21 to 18. And Mom, plug your ears for a second. Because we decided to go get some beer. I think John Farmer, Mike Rowling, and I were going to go camping. And so I was 18, so we went into Lambert's and we ran in really fast. John sat in the parking lot and kept the engine running. Something was really dangerous and forbidden about what we were doing. We ran and got the beer, paid for it, and I turned around. And his hand reached out. Tapped the beer twice. Tap. Don't drink it all at once. That time as I was twinkling, and that was he had a sense of humor that was just brilliant. His timing was amazing. Another time, he used another tried and true teaching technique, bribery. He wrote a solo for me that was terrifying. It was it ended on a high C. Mention Dave Mackey's name to him. So I play it, and I'm standing in front of the 50-yard line, Lakeshore High School, it's freezing, and we all were really worrying if I could hit this high C. Watson, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, we had to play all the time, brass players. And Bob Brown walked up to me, and he waved a $5 bill. And he said, Bucky, if you nail it, this is yours. Bribery. It's a great technique. So, Annette, I'd like this to be the first $5 for the... two final points. I mean, there's so many on the Facebook page, maybe three. He was a musician. And when you had your birthday, the best present you could have is when you played Happy Birthday. Did this little vamp thing, and we just, oh man. And that credibility behind what he was doing, we knew this guy. guy had chops. He could play the woodwind instrument like crazy. So he was also not a slave to fashion. Remember his legendary white t-shirts at band camp? I mean, who thought up that wardrobe? Do you think he thought for a second about anything else but music?
T-shirt. Done.
And there's also a pretty good picture of Steve, by the way, with your hat and shorts, which is not to be missed. Throw that up there sometime. That would be good. But now we thought about music. We were true band geeks, and that came first. So let me be frank about this. He had a gifted teacher. He knew more than the basics. He taught us that that every song or routine would never be perfect, that we could approach perfection. So I just want to share this last statement Darla Pechtel sent this in. And I think Annette, you read this to him. It was, the ultimate was how you sculpture the routines near the end. Remember this? He'd line us up backwards, and we'd slowly turn to the stance. Then Watson remembers this, we'd take our horns. That was great. That was it. So I might have to do that afterwards. So they say the sign of a good teacher is that you become immortal because you the lessons live on. Folks, I was on the airplane this morning. The pilot said, I have bad news. There's too much fog. We're going to be late. And I usually get really freaked out. But this time I said, you know, I think I have a friend up there in the stands, in the press box. Sure enough, the pilot said, you know, I'll be darned, the fog cleared. And not only that, we're going to be 15 minutes early, so I was on time for rehearsal. So, we all have somebody in the press box. Don't forget that. If he was here, he wouldn't want us to be sad, and he'd want us to celebrate the fact that we got to be with this incredible person. And he'd want us to surround you guys with love. Just look around. Thank you, and it's my honor to introduce Michelle Siebel, who is here. Michelle, I think it's your turn. Thank you very much.
Mr. Brown leaves a legacy of outstanding performances and musicianship that speak to his talent and his skill and devotion. Through the framework of his expectations, we were encouraged, prodded, cheered, driven, inspired, admonished, and even cajoled into doing and giving and being our very best. We learned that hard work, responsibility, and ownership led not only to outstanding results, but also built a team, a family that worked and cared for each other. Now as an adult and as a music teacher, I find myself working to try to build that same kind of classroom community that Mr. Brown did so capably and effectively. He gave me some of the most memorable and meaningful moments of my years as a student. By my senior year, I knew when the clipboard was going to come flying down from the top of that ladder out of the marching field. And I knew that he would stomp away, and yet every time it happened, I felt driven and propelled to work harder and give more and expect everybody around me to do the same. And the results were there. Which now as an adult, I look back and think, he knew we could do it. He would never have done that if he hadn't been able to count on us and didn't know our skills and our dedication and our musicianship. So I am so grateful for the part that he played and continues to play as I strive to do and give my best to my family, my students, and my community. Thank you so much, Mr. Brown.
Steve mentioned when I was hired to be a part of the fine arts department in St. Joe, I felt like I had the dream job. But I also knew a little bit about the heritage that the fine arts department in St. Joe had. I did not have the advantage of 2 years teaching experience when I came to Steve. I was fresh. And I was also about half of Bob's size. I can remember the more I learned about what Bob along and Dennis has been mentioning, and you'll hear from Dennis and everything that I could say about Bob goes for Dennis also. But all that I learned, I knew that the fine arts department in St. Joe represented. I knew I had a big task in front of me. I was right out of college. I was trained as a music educator instrumentally and chorally, but my focus had always been choral. And when I came to St. Joe, I was going to be preparing students that were going to Bob. Did my first marching band show my first year of teaching, and Bob was so supportive. Marching band show in the stadium at halftime with the big band. And Bob was so supportive, but at the end of that show, I knew that it wasn't the excellence that Bob would really expect. So I can remember after my first year of teaching, I began working on my master's down at Ball State, and one of the classes, first classes I signed up for was marching band techniques. And that summer I wrote a show that I had planned to do the next football season. When the junior high band, I failed to mention that, I was preparing students at Upton, the country club school, because we had just divided from Milton. And I was preparing those kids from the country club to move into Bob's band. But I can remember coming back after that summer, my first summer of grad school, and going over to Bob's house and showing him the show, and with the hopes that it would have the excellence that he prepared all of the students that were under his baton. I think Bucky mentioned a master teacher, and Bob was a master teacher. And normally when we hear the term master teacher, we think of a teacher of students for which they are in charge. Bob was also a master teacher to younger teachers. I learned a lot from him, and I'll have it around with you. I really believe that a lot of the excellence, if I can say I had some excellent times in my career, were from working with people like Bob and Dennis. I was also privileged to have Kim and Angie as students. So I got to know Bob and Annette as parents also, and the same characteristics that Bob expected in his classrooms were shown in his family.
Thank you. Thank you. than the greatest club in the world has known. This is the love I'll give to you alone. More than the simple words I try to say, with it.
But anyway, the switch didn't turn off one time. You know what's coming. I'm up in the press box, everybody's concentrating on the marching band, and I'm making a comment about the crooked trombone rope. Well, the mic wasn't off. The superintendent Dick Zimmer turned around and looked at me like I had lost my mind. Everybody turned around and went, "We heard you." But do you know what? The trombones were never crooked again. Now, I don't know what Bob had to say about this. He never came to me with it. He may have talked at home about it, but he didn't say anything to me about it. But I'd like to think that secretly, he was glad I did that. So, we think fondly of you, Bob. Thank you.
This time, Angie has passed on the words to the alma mater. Hopefully, most of you have received those words or have them locked into your memory. And if you could turn the lights up a little bit so that those of us that do need to read the words, yeah, that's great. Dennis is going to play one time through, and this will be all of our opportunities, one more opportunity to sing one last alma mater on behalf of Bob. Let's all stand.
Thank you. memories and talking about this for so many weeks in preparation. It's kind of like, how do we narrow it down? Because obviously, how do we narrow it down? Dad had so many different personalities, applications. It was so hard to really narrow it down. And even with the slideshow, you'll see, keep it to, I think it was around 15 minutes, it was just really a challenge. There are scrapbooks in the band room where we're hopefully all going to meet and talk more stories, all that kind of stuff, and have something to eat together. But he kept so many scrapbooks, so many pictures. You'll find yourselves in those scrapbooks because I think he kept a record of every single picture from all the years. And I think, and actually putting this together, there were very few pictures in the scrapbooks of himself. It was all the students, and that was really him. He was all about the students, and I don't know, you know, I want to take a personal moment to thank all my teachers, because I think teaching is such a calling, and it can be a thankless job, it can be frustrating, because anybody who is around teachers knows or is a teacher. And one thing I know is my dad fought valiantly for students to make sure that fine arts was expanded and given hours within the day, and not just extracurricular. And I don't think a lot of people realize how much teachers do fight for the students. So I want to thank my teachers, Mr. Baldwin, who I think I told him this before. Probably my primary instrument was singing. I was also in band, but I remember him saying in seventh grade that vibrato was cool and would play, current songs where people sing about vibrato, and that just left a mark on me that was really cool and something to be excited about. Of course, Mr. Bowman, who is legendary and gave me such a passion for singing, and I'll never forget him for that. And of course, Mr. Reed, Mr. Tenorelli, who was in junior high, he's here too. And Mr. Reed was in orchestra with him, and then my dad, of course, who gave, so many people that he came into contact with a passion for music. And I think everybody knows we're so fortunate to have these quality caliber teachers in St. Joseph, and have impacted so many lives. And anyone who's a teacher, definitely those of them that I just mentioned, just know that's one regret, is that all the outpouring on Facebook, that my dad didn't get to see that. He would, I think someone said on there, he would have been embarrassed, and that's true. He would have been very embarrassed, but at the same time, would have been so touched. And in his final days, I don't know how many of you know, but he fought a very hard battle with COPD, with lung disease, and then also chronic heart failure. But through it all, he, even up until, the last couple weeks of his life, he fought valiantly in physical therapy and trying to get better, the same determination that he used throughout his whole life in teaching, and then passed on to all of us. And I think that we'll benefit, if we haven't already benefited in our lives, with that type of tenacity, persistence, discipline, definitely, benefit from that going forward. And so last of all, I just want to say to anybody, I don't know if you saw the slideshow, that one big group of kids in the front yard, that was actually the front yard of our house, and the toilet paper hanging from the trees, we had to clean that up. All the people throughout the years who toilet papered our house because they thought it was a joke on my dad, us who had to clean it up, so thank you very much.
Robert W. Brown's memorial service. And we're trying not to tell all the stories that are keep coming up.
And it's also trying to recognize people before they recognize us.
Yes, it's really hard. Yes.
What the?
Passing notes around. Yes.
All right, guys.
Old.
Yeah, I know. Everyone's like,
what happened
to you?
Yeah, another chat.
Oh, sad.
All right. So sad.